Happy Sunday, Willingdon Church, and for those who are watching online as well. King David said in Psalm 122, verse 1, he was so glad when he heard him said, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Amen. Can I please invite you to come stand with us and sing? Okay, because in the house of the Lord is always joy. Amen.
God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging seas. My God, he holds the victory. Yeah. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Let's sing together.
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross, and he rose up from that grave. My God still wrote his songs away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the And we won't be quiet, no. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Worship the ever-living God who's worthy of our praise, Jesus Christ.
With His heart open wide, from the depths, from the heights, I will bring a sacrifice. With these hands lifted high, hear my song, hear my cry. I will bring sacrifice. I will bring a sacrifice.
I lay me down, I'm not my own. I belong to you alone. Lay me down, lay me down. Oh, hands on my heart, this much is true. There's no life apart from you. Lay me down, lay me down.
Letting go of my pride, giving up all my rights, take this life.
What he's You this morning. We pray that we may have worshipful hearts as we hear your word and as we go on from here and apply it to our daily lives, Lord. We love you. We praise you. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning, everybody. You may have a seat. It is great to be here with you this morning and get to welcome you here. A warm welcome if you are new. If you're watching online as well, welcome here. My name is Maria. I am a pastoral intern here at our church family, and I get to share some cool news with you this morning. So first of all, if you are new here and you haven't connected with us yet, please fill out our Connect card. It is orange. You can find it in the seat back in front of you. Fill out your information there and drop it off at the Welcome Center. We'd love to say hello to you in person and reach out via email and just get you in the know with what's happening at our church family. If you are part of our church family, I want to turn your attention to our purple envelope. If you would like to give as a form of worship and obedience to our God, feel free to fill that out, drop it off at the Resource Center. You can also use other forms of payment there as well, and they can get you set up with other information. Good news for you all. Our Christmas presentation is coming up, and we still have some tickets for that. So if you haven't bought your ticket yet, hurry, don't wait. There are very few left for the Thursday presentation only at 7 p.m. Go upstairs for more information about that. And for the ladies in the room, I have an announcement for you as well. On December 1st, we will be celebrating the Advent season with a Christmas dessert night. Our event is called Awaiting, and we will talk about Advent and how we get to wait in hope and joy for Jesus' birth, for Christmas, and for the rest of the year as well. So come for that. It is December 1st at 7 p.m. You can find more information online and register there. Now I would like to turn your attention to the screen. We'll watch a video together.
Can I do that again?
Sorry.
Hey, Willingdon family. My name is Robbie. I'm currently serving as the pastor for the college and career community.
My name is Jonathan. I'm the new Life Groups pastor here at Willingdon.
My name is Ruben. I am serving as outreach pastor in Willingdon.
Greetings, Willingdon Church. My name is Brian Bourne, and I've been invited to serve as the pastor for theological education. Well, if you want to know a fun fact about me, I like hunting for rocks, and then I cut and polish them.
About me, I do collectible cards and different scales, 124, 180, and smaller. Also, I have stamp collections. I have 5 volumes of stamps I collect since I was 12 years old.
Yeah, I'm going to see those.
Yeah, I will bring that.
My fun fact seems so much more boring compared to these guys. I've driven from the East Coast, the Atlantic, all the way to the Pacific West Coast, just over years, but not at one trip.
Oh.
But yeah, nice. But I've been in a car to both sides of the, and everywhere in between.
Me too, nice. Yeah, I
do that. Interesting fact about myself, so my name Robbie is actually not short for anything. It's actually a hybrid of my parents' name. So my dad's name is Rolando and my mom's name is Ruby. So you get those two together and Rolando. You get Robbie.
What I'm looking forward to most is exploring God's word with God's people so that together we might be more faithful servants and witnesses of Jesus Christ in God's world.
I want to revive the church mission trips here in Willingdon Church to connect with all the Willingdon family and equip them to go to support our overseas missionaries. Also, I would like to reach out the community here in Barnaby and the Greater Vancouver to bring the Willingdon family to serve the different needs of the community. We're having people from everywhere, every country, every language here just crossing the street. So I think this is a great opportunity for us to work together to be the hands and feet of Jesus in the community.
I want to be with you.
Thank you.
I'm looking forward to working together with all of the amazing life group leaders to know and to work how we can gather, grow, and go our life groups. And looking forward to see the spiritual growth and, Lord willing, the multiplication of our life groups at Willingdon Church.
I'm looking forward to partnering with and also raising up Christ-like servant leaders from the college and career community.
So yeah, join me in welcoming these new pastors. So if you didn't catch it, Pastor Robbie is the young adults pastor, still single. Sorry, forgive me. We'll talk about forgiveness in a minute. Pastor Jonathan, married to Mitzi. They have a son, Caleb, the life group's pastor. Pastor Brian, married to Teresa, and he'll be the pastor of theological education. and Pastor Ruben, married to Linda, our new outreach pastor. So we're so thankful for you. It's so good to invite you into our pastoral team and encourage you to minister in this wonderful church family. Paul and Ken are elders here at church, and they want to pray for you.
Can I ask my church family to stand up with, join me with the prayer? Let's pray then. Father God, we thank you for your steadfast love and faithfulness in guiding these brothers to join this church family to serve. God, we humbly pray empowerment to these chosen brothers. You're giving them the courage, the wisdom, the knowledge in their ministry. Father, we also lift up their family to you, seeking your blessings, protections, and love. Thank you, Lord. In your precious name we pray.
Lord, I just want to echo that and just thank you for bringing these men to us. It's a blessing as a family to have them serve here. We just thank you for your calling on their lives. Thank you that you've blessed us in this way. Lord, I pray for favor in their ministries where they work. I pray for wisdom. Lord, I pray for joy in the service you have for them. And Lord, as they work here, Lord, I pray that you would primarily, as amongst us, they would be blessed in their work, but in their personal lives as well, Lord, that you would cause each of their hearts to grow more and more in love with you each day and in love with your word. Lord, I pray as a family that you would give us insight into how we can serve them as they serve us and bless them as they bless us. Lord, I thank you again for calling them to Willingdon. Amen.
Please be seated.
Amen. Okay. You can stay standing, actually, for the reading of God's word. So, yeah, bless you. Take time to say hello to them in the lobby or the hallway, wherever you might meet them today. Maria.
We will be reading this morning out of Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 to 20. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. This is the word of the Lord. Please have a seat. Yeah.
Thank you, Maria. Okay, let's just pray. Father, we do thank you that you have preserved your word for us, and we thank you for the instruction that it contains, these words of Jesus to us as his followers. And thank you, Jesus, that you're present by your Spirit to teach us. I pray that we would hear well, that your words would fall on soft soil in our hearts, and that we would not only receive them, but understand them and know how to put them into practice. So we trust you for that grace. It's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Amen. So today, we're talking about something that is common to every human being on earth, every person breathing in this room here today. Sooner or later in life, we will take offense. In fact, we will experience this throughout our life journey. Why would this happen? Why would we be so prone to taking offense? Well, we only need to look at the context of the verses that Maria just read. For example, in chapter 17, we see that Jesus shares a secret with some disciples. Have you ever shared a secret with a person or a group of people? They're your close friends. You do it in confidence, and they share the secret with others. Or someone accuses you of being faithless or prayerless. I remember a season in my life when I was really trying to grow in prayer. I was reading prayers in Scripture, studying them. I was reading books on prayer. I was even trying to spend more time in prayer and fasting. And it was exactly in that moment that someone came up to me and said, "Ray, you are prayerless." What do you do when you receive that kind of accusation? There are so many opportunities to take offense. To take offense is simply to become bitter or resentful because someone has mistreated you, disregarded you, maybe even attacked you. So if this is the experience of every human being, what do we do? Today's message is the first part of a two-part message, so you have to come back next week. Today we're going to focus on restoration. And then next week we're going to talk about something that is essential, whether we experience restoration or don't experience restoration. It's probably even more critical when we don't experience restoration, when it just doesn't happen. In chapter 17, Jesus mentions for the second time that he's going to suffer in Jerusalem. He's going to die and then be raised again. So he's preparing his disciples for his departure. And what he does in chapter 18, he talks about what their life together should look like when he's gone. After he's gone, something should mark their relationships that will show people around them that he truly is the Messiah, that he's present among them. And what will their relationships look like? Well, Pastor Vin talked about this a bit last week. He started in verses 1 through 14. And so people that follow Jesus, they should be marked by this desire to walk toward one another in humility. The little ones should be received and loved. Those who are straying should be sought after. The truth is that when it comes to our relationships, sin is always crouching at the door, always threatening to disrupt our relationships. And so in today's passage, Jesus talks about what we do when someone sins against us. We go to them. Now, confronting another person is about as popular as a spanking your child in the supermarket. It's about as popular as a public hanging. So why would we ever do this? Well, the first reason, it's taken from the immediate context. Verse 15, the first verse that Maria read, it flows from verses 10 to 14. And in those verses, a brother or sister is straying. The person has sinned. That person's in spiritual danger. And Jesus cares. Jesus really cares. He loves that person. He gave his life for that person. The second reason is that we are family. We are connected. Jesus uses family language. We're brothers and sisters who follow Jesus. We're not called to be prosecutors, but brothers and sisters that reach out to one another in love. We're our brother's keepers. We can never say as followers of Jesus, well, just live and let live. That kind of language cannot be on our lips. We can't say everyone's just made to free to make their own choices as long as they don't hurt anyone. That's not the language of love. That's the language of permissive apathy. It's the language of people who just don't care. The third reason is the nature of sin. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his fantastic book, Life Together, if you haven't read it, give it a read. It's a short little book on community life. And he wrote about the nature of sin so eloquently. This is what he wrote. Sin demands to have a man by himself. It withdraws him from the community. The more isolated a person is, the more destructive will be the power of sin over him. And the more deeply he becomes involved in it, the more disastrous is his isolation. Sin wants to remain unknown. It shuns the light. unchecked sin destroys people. Satan wants to isolate and destroy people. If he can separate us through offense, through bitterness, through resentment, he knows that he has a secure foothold in our hearts and in the life of the church family. Look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 26. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. That word foothold is a place from which he can act. The fourth reason is this. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. I take that quotation from 1 Corinthians chapter 5. And in the context of 1 Corinthians chapter 5, the problem is one of incest in the church family. Pretty serious. But the truth is that sexual promiscuity always hurts people, always damages relationships, always endangers the community. People become objects. They're used and discarded. And so when we confront sin, we're doing that out of love for the person who is straying, who's in danger, and out of love for the whole church family. James 5, verse 20. Whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. Now you might say, okay, we've got lots of reasons to go to our brother or sister who has offended us, but how would we ever do this? I was reading my journal this week from 2002, and on June 6th of 2002, our youngest daughter was in school. I went to pick her up. As soon as she got into the car, she said, "Dad, the worst day of my life." The worst. Everything went wrong. She said, "I was scolded by my teacher, by my coordinator, by the school principal. All I got today was a lecture." And I think scolding was probably a bit of an exaggeration. She was a bit emotional. So I said, so why did they scold you? She says, "Well, this morning we were in PE class and my friend had a sore hand. And my PE teacher made my friend play volleyball. So I got my classmates together and we wrote down all of our complaints, we signed the petition, and I took it straight to the school principal to get rid of him, get him fired." She said, "Everything went wrong." Because what had the school principal done? He had said, "Okay, it's good for you to express your views, have your opinions, but the first thing you need to do is talk to your PE teacher about what's bothering you. And if that doesn't work, well, then you go to the coordinator. And if the coordinator doesn't listen, then you come with your class to my office." So he was teaching her some principles that actually come right out of Matthew chapter 18. He was applying it to the educational environment. She was learning some early lessons on how to resolve conflict. Worst day of her life. But for me as a father, it was a great day. Why? Because here she was at 8 years of age, learning some skills that she would have to apply throughout her life. She was learning about taking offense, difficult relationships, lines of accountability, governance. She's 30 years old now, and she has continued to face conflict over and over again in her professional life. We face conflict when we're 5 years old, 8 years old, 28, 38, 48, throughout life. So again, what do we do? Before we study the process that Jesus outlines here in verses 15 to 20, I want to look at the parallel passage, which is in Luke chapter 17, verse 3. Jesus says, "Pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him." Notice how it begins. It begins with, pay attention to yourself. Before we pay attention to someone else's sin, we need to examine ourselves. Jesus says something very similar in the Sermon on the Mount. This is Matthew 7, verse 3. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when there's a log in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. So in Matthew chapter 18, Jesus just assumes that the person that is going to his or her brother, or his brother or sister, just assuming that the person is going with humility, with an awareness of their own sinfulness, their own weaknesses. If it's hard to receive correction, it's probably even harder to go confront another person in a spirit of true humility. It really requires God's grace. Before going to talk to our brother or sister that has offended us, maybe we should ask ourselves questions like these. One, have we contributed to the conflict in any way? Do we have any part in what's going on? Two, are we aware of our failings and shortcomings? Three, are we wanting to confront others for their sin just so that we feel better than them? Four, is it truly the love of Christ that is compelling us, motivating us? Our posture has to be one of loving concern, not self-righteous judgment. So now let's look at the process that Jesus outlines. Verse 15 again. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. If could be when. When your brother sins against you, because your brothers and sisters are going to sin against you. What are some telltale signs that we are actually carrying offense? Here are a few. One, we distance ourselves from the person, at least emotionally, right? Two, we think about that person much more than we should, even at night when we should be sleeping. Have any of you experienced this? Raise your hand if you have. Those that didn't raise your hands, you're lying. And I will confront you after the service for your sin. No, it's just common to being human, right? We're offended. We start thinking about that person during the day, even at night. Three, we tell others what the person has done. When we're offended, Jesus' first step is to go. It's a command. It's an order. The command is not to sulk. How could that person have done that to me? Or secondly, to wait. I'm not going to move until he makes the first move. Or three, deny. Oh, don't worry. Nothing happened. I'm just staying awake at night because of it, but nothing happened. Or four, give the cold shoulder. I'll just distance myself. I can't trust him anymore. Jesus doesn't say that we should plan revenge. It's number five. Okay, I'm just going to wait for the right opportunity. He is going to be so sorry that he did that to me. Number six, gossip. Did you hear what he did to me? Jesus doesn't command us to do those things. He says, go. Step one is a gentle, private conversation between the two of you. Tell him his fault, Jesus says. It carries the idea of bringing to light the person's wrongdoing, because maybe the person isn't even aware of their wrongdoing. We all have blind spots. And the aim is not to score points over the other person. It's to gain your brother, Jesus says, to win over your sister, to have the relationship restored. The intent of the process, the intent of what you do, it is always restoration. Restoration. Not punishment. Jesus adds, between you and him alone, or just between the two of you. I like the Jerusalem Bible here. It's a little more aggressive. Go and have it out with him alone. So, if the matter can be settled without getting more people involved, what happens? Well, rumors, misunderstandings, they're kept from multiplying. Because these things that we say to others about how people have offended us, they spread like wildfire. And once they're out there, you can never, ever bring them back. Never. So the principle is one of minimum exposure. About a year ago, a fellow pastor came to talk to me. He was offended with something that I had said. And he came with humility. He came ready to forgive me. But he came really needing to talk to me about something that had offended him. It was bothering him. I was ready to repent just because of the way that he approached me. So he confronted me, and on that occasion, I had to admit my wrongdoing. I was in the wrong. I had to make some changes. But it was a private conversation between the two of us. And I felt honored. I felt loved. Both of us were able to move forward in peace. And now you're all curious, what had I said? You're primed to fall into temptation. There's so much temptation around offense, right? Isn't there? So many ways to fall into the gutter. If we're offended, we want to talk to others before we talk to the person who offended us. We ask others to share our grievance. And we who are listening, aren't we sometimes eager to hear about the other's shortcomings? You see, when we behave in this way, we're causing others to sin. Jesus, in the context in Matthew 18, he talks about those who cause others to sin, and he pronounces a woe on them. Are we not drawing others into temptation and sin when we go to them and ask them to share our offense? Sometimes secondary offense is worse than the first offense. What are the reasons that we give for not going directly to the one who has offended us? Well, here's a number. One, we don't believe that the person will listen. You ever thought that? No, he or she, they're just going to justify themselves. Another reason, this is not the first time they've offended us. There's a pattern. I don't have much hope for redemption here. The third reason, we don't want to admit that we've been hurt. We're too proud. A fourth reason that maybe reflects some humility. I'm not perfect. Who am I to confront my brother or sister? And then maybe the fifth reason, which is the most sobering, we don't really believe that God can change things. We don't really believe he can do anything. Interestingly, Jesus doesn't ask us to write down our reasons for not going. He says, go. Commands us to go. But you might ask, but what do we do if we go and our brother or sister just doesn't listen to us? Well, Jesus already thought about that. Verse 16. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. Jesus is quite realistic here. When confronted for their wrongdoing, people often become defensive. Sometimes they dig in even harder because they're proud and they start defending themselves. They take offense because you've confronted them. Who are you? Well, if the private conversation doesn't work, Jesus says, invite two or three others into the conversation. They may not have been eyewitnesses to the offense, but they become witnesses to this attempt to work for restoration. These witnesses, they can do a number of things. First of all, they can protect the person being confronted from false accusation. It's important. Secondly, they can help the offending party see their sin. Because again, maybe the offending party just has a blind spot. Third, they can be public witnesses if the matter has to be taken to the church family. And please note this, these are brother-to-brother conversations, sister-to-sister conversations. These are peer-to-peer conversations. An elder or deacon is not mentioned. You go to the person in private. If that doesn't work, you bring two or three other brothers and sisters. You have a conversation. And then you might ask, well, what if that doesn't work? Well, Jesus has thought about this as well. Verse 17, if he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. So if the offending party simply refuses to listen, simply ignores what is being said, you take the matter to the church family. And in the early church, this would have been a small group of believers, a house church. So in the context of Willingdon Church, probably something like a life group. But anyways, a small group. And at this point, the offending party should realize that it's serious. It's people aren't just seeing it as that person's, you know, sensitive nature. There's actually something to be dealt with. The key word is listen. Listen. In this case, the offending party is not even giving those who confront him the time of day. He's being incorrigible. So the posture of the process, it has to be one of listening for all involved. The intent of the process is restoration. The posture of the process is one of listening, listening. If the offending party refuses to listen, even after being brought before this small group of believers, then he or she is to be treated like a Gentile or a tax collector. Well, what does that mean? Well, Jesus is using this language to describe those who just don't value relationship between brothers and sisters, those who don't have a true relationship with God, those who are putting themselves first. They're above the counsel of other people. They repudiate the pastoral care offered. They betray the church family. And so Jesus says a person that's behaving like that should not be participating in the life of the church family. They shouldn't be coming to the Lord's Supper, which is this sign of Jesus' death on our behalf, an expression of our love for him and for the church family. It would be hypocritical to participate. A person that's living like that should not be in leadership in the church family because that person's participation would put the whole church family in danger. Imagine the decision-making process of a person that has taken offense or has offended the church family. So, because Jesus is very aware of the nature of sin, he gives this instruction to his first disciples, and it's for us as well. Now, the question will probably come from the offending party in some situations. Well, who are you to judge me? Who are you to come and talk to me about my sin? What authority do you have? Well, first of all, let's remember again, the intent of the whole conversation is one of restoration. Menno Simons, the 16th century reformer, he wrote these words, I quote him, "We do not want to expel any, but rather to receive. Not to amputate, but rather to heal. Not to discard, but rather to win back. Not to grieve, but rather to comfort, not to condemn, but rather to save. The intent is restoration. Now, having said this, Jesus does confer authority to the church family to determine what is and what is not permitted in the church family and to outline a process of restoration. Verse 18, truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. The authority doesn't come from a position, from an office, but from the authority of Jesus conferred to his people. You know, there's always going to be a tension between God's authority and our human fallibility. I like what Bible commentator R.T. France writes about this. The fact that God has given his people the role of declaring his will on earth does not mean that he is bound to add his divine sanction to anything they may think of. If we're involved in this kind of a process of working with people toward restoration and there's ongoing conflict, we need to remember that not everything that we think and do is according to God's will. We need to walk with humility. We're simply God's instrument. Perhaps the next few verses are helpful to elucidate, to clarify what kind of community can exercise authority in Jesus' name. Verse 19, Jesus says, again I say to you, again could be moreover, moreover I say to you. Jesus is adding to what he's already said. Verses 19 and 20, continuing. If two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I among them. Now, these verses are often taken out of context. You know, sometimes people will use it in this way. Well, if just two or three are gathered, well, then God's going to be in our worship service. If two or three of us just agree in prayer, well, then God's going to do it. That's a misapplication of these verses. Notice that they're given in the context of conflict resolution. In these verses, there's a forward look. Jesus is looking forward to the time after his resurrection and ascension, after his departure. After he has ascended to the Father, he will be present with his disciples by his Spirit. At the end of Matthew chapter 8, 28, he promises, I will be with you to the end of the age. He truly is Emmanuel. He is God with us. So these verses are about the kind of church family that can exercise Jesus' authority. One, this church family gathers and prays in Jesus' name. What does that mean? Well, we pray according to his character and according to his will. This church family acts in agreement. The word agree in this verse here, it has the notion of sounding together in harmony. So we agree in prayer, in unity before God, having considered his will. Our decisions, they're actually bathed in prayer. And then the third is just Jesus' presence. It's palpable. So as this church prays for the offending brother to be restored, prays for the one who has taken offense, prays for a spirit of humility and repentance, prays for the restoration of relationship, cries out to God for this, and asks God for guidance on how to proceed, Jesus makes himself present. The spirit of the process is Jesus' presence. The intent of the process is restoration. The posture of the process is one of listening. The spirit of the process is Jesus' presence. So in summary, we confront the person who sins against us with the intent of seeing that person restored. Listening is critical for everyone involved. The presence of Jesus is essential, and Jesus guides us as we pray. By his Spirit, he empowers us to act in humility according to his will. The Spirit of Jesus always works for repentance, healing, and restoration. I spoke to you earlier about my daughter, 8-year-old daughter, who on June 6th of 2002 was learning some lessons around conflict, interpersonal conflict. In my journal of that same month, end of the month, June 29th of 2002, I had written some things about interpersonal conflict. I was 43 at the time. And God was teaching me some things about how to work through conflict. It seems that we never graduate from this course. I believed at that time that I had been falsely accused by a few people. So I tried to put Matthew 18 into practice. I went to those people in private. They didn't listen, so I gathered a few others to have conversation. And even though there were many witnesses, no one owned anything. The matter was never fully resolved. Some of the people involved in that conflict, they've passed away. A few months ago, I received a Facebook message from a person involved in that conflict. She was asking for forgiveness 20 years later. So what do we do when we can't find resolution? This may be your experience in your family, or the workplace, or the church family. Maybe this church family or another church family. Jesus invites us into a process. He says, if you truly are my disciples, you will do these things, but he doesn't actually guarantee an outcome. If you just do this, everything's going to be okay. Everything will be restored. Don't worry. There's no guarantee. In June of 2002, I wrote down some lessons I was learning. 14 lessons. You learn a lot when you go through conflict. One thing I wrote down was this: Jesus is never fooled or mocked. Nothing is hidden from his sight. We can rest in that. Two, our real enemy is the evil one, not the people involved. He is trying to destroy us and destroy the church family. Three, if we've suffered through unresolved conflict, God is always working redemptively. You can be quite sure that almost everyone that you're in relationship with has suffered through unresolved conflict, and God can help us be wounded healers. We can share with others what we have received from the Lord. The truth is that confronting those who have sinned does not always lead to restoration. But there is one thing that we can practice that will free us, that will empower us to move forward with faith. And what is it? I'm out of time. And we're going to talk about it next week. We will, should God give us life until next Sunday. But there is, I just want you to know, there is something that we can practice, no matter what happens. Whether the conflict is resolved or unresolved, there is something that we can practice that will truly free us and empower us to move forward with faith. We don't need to remain bound. Today we talked about the process. The intent of the process is restoration. The posture of the process, listening. Everyone listening well. We need the Holy Spirit to help us listen well. The spirit of the process is Jesus' presence. Jesus loves the one who has taken offense. He loves the offending party. He loves the church family. When we invite him in, he's ready to work. So, again, you might ask, why do we do these things? Well, we do these things because of the one that we follow, the one that we serve. Jesus poured out his life. He gave his life for us, sinners. If we're following him, we will pour out ourselves. We will do whatever we can so that people, relationships can be restored. That's the way of Jesus. That's his way. So may we follow his way, trusting him to be at work.
Amen.
The call on us is to be obey, to go. The outcome, well, we leave that in Jesus' hands.
Amen.
Whatever happens, he will be glorified if we obey him. Amen. Let's pray. So, Father, again, we thank you for your instruction. If we just lived according to our own inclinations, we probably would just walk away from our brothers and sisters. But you're present within us by your Spirit. You are God with us. And so if you have given us a command, then you're present to equip us and empower us to obey the command. And to do that, trusting you to be at work in our hearts and in the lives of others, trusting you to do more than we could ever ask or imagine. And so, Lord, may you have your way in us today. If there's someone that we need to talk to, may we go and talk. May we go in humility. We ask for that grace. If someone comes to us and says, hey, there's something I need to resolve with you, may we be ready to receive. May we listen well. Thank you, Jesus, that we're not alone. Thank you that you've promised to be with us right to the end of the age. So we trust you, Lord, to do your work in us, through us, for your glory. Amen. Amen. Here are some questions for your reflection.
I invite you to stand, and we're going to respond with this song that can be a prayer for you as well. As you think about what it is that the Lord is inviting you into, it's going to be a challenge, but take heart that he is with you. And even when you feel crushed and pressed on every side, that he is doing a new work, a good work, for your good and for his glory. So if you want to take this time to have someone pray with you as well, there will be elders, pastors, and life group leaders at the front who would be more than happy to pray with you over these things as we sing and worship. crushing, in the pressing, you are making me wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you into your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. Make me a vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. You are breaking, you are breaking new ground. So make me a vessel, make me an offering, make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me, Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. 'Cause where there is new wine, there is new power, there is new freedom, and the key
spring new wine out of us. May we, the grace of God be evident as we try to practice these words of Jesus. And just know that the Holy Spirit is present to help you practice these things. We depend on Him. We need Him. In these moments of conflict, we need Him desperately, don't we? So, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. May the Lord of peace Himself give you peace at all times in every way. God bless you.